Hello and welcome to Films and Beer, the very first retrospective that we're going to make. And today's film may be one that people are familiar with because of the iconic line being cemented in pop culture through parody and mimicry, as well as outstanding reverence. But we are winding back the clocks to see where it all started. The year was 1976. And the film was Taxi Driver. The origin of Taxi Driver came from what writer Paul Schrader called a dark place. At the time, Schrader was a film critic for the Los Angeles Free Press, but found himself being dealt quite a few significant blows in his personal life. And as Schrader put in a 2019 interview for the Toronto International Film Festival, "I had to write this character or else I would become him." That character was, of course, Travis Bickle. After initially putting the script down and continuing to work as a film critic, and also writing and successfully selling the neo-noir crime drama The Yakuza, Schrader met and interviewed Brian De Palma, who subsequently read the script and passed it along to Martin Scorsese, stating that he thought Scorsese would love to direct the film. However, when Scorsese lobbied for direction of the film to Michael and Julia Phillips, who had acquired the script, he was rejected. At the time, Scorsese had only really done two feature-length films, Who's That Knocking at My Door and Boxcar Bertha. And according to Scorsese, Julia Phillips would periodically reject him, saying, "Come around again when you've done something more than Boxcar Bertha." It was only after the producing couple saw a rough cut of Scorsese's next film, Mean Streets, recommended to them by Paul Schrader, that they agreed Scorsese was the director to bring the film to life. The part of the unhinged lead character Travis Bickle was originally offered to Dustin Hoffman, who subsequently turned it down as he thought Scorsese was, quote, crazy, after he came to Hoffman to discuss the role with no script. According to Hoffman himself, he didn't know who Scorsese was at the time, and has since called his rejection of the role a dumb mistake, saying, "I remember meeting Martin Scorsese. He had no script, and I didn't know who he was. I hadn't seen any of his films, and he was talking a mile a minute, telling me what the movie was about. I thought the guy was crazy. I made so many dumb mistakes. The list is endless." The role was then presented to Robert De Niro, who Scorsese had worked and collaborated with on Mean Streets in 1973. De Niro was coming off the back of winning an Academy Award for his performance in The Godfather Part II and jumped to the chance to work with Scorsese again. In order to prepare for the role of Travis Bickle, De Niro studied the behaviour of taxi drivers and even obtained a taxi driver's license, and for a few weeks took fares and drove around New York at night. De Niro would soon become a long-time collaborator of Scorsese's, working with him on 11 films. For the role of Wizard, the late Peter Boyle was cast. Boyle started his career in 1966 with an uncredited role in The Group, but would later get his break taking the lead role in the 1970 drama Joe. Boyle would become a well-known character actor in the 1970s, working alongside some of Hollywood's greats, including Robert Redford in the 1972 classic The Candidate, James Caan in the 1973 film Slither, and again in 1973 working with Dennis Hopper in the film Kid Blue, along with other actors like Donald Sutherland. Later in his career, Boyle would become known for arguably one of the best episodes of The X-Files, where he played Clyde Bruckman in the episode titled Clyde Bruckman's Final Repose. He would also more notably appear in the sitcom Everybody Loves Raymond, where he played Frank Barone. Sybil Shepherd was cast in the role of Betsy, who Travis Bickle becomes obsessed. Shepherd's first film experience came in 1971 with the critical and commercial darling The Last Picture Show, where she starred alongside Jeff Bridges. The film would go on to be nominated for 8 Academy Awards and winning 2. Shepard was also nominated for a Golden Globe for Most Promising Newcomer. She would also land a series of roles in such films as The Heartbreak Kid in 1972, Daisy Miller in 1974, and At Long Last Love in 1975 before working with Scorsese on Taxi Driver. After a few less than successful roles, Shepard moved back to her hometown of Memphis to experience stage acting in regional theatre. Shepard would later return to Hollywood with the career-defining role of Maddie Hayes in the 1985 comedy drama Moonlighting. The role of Sport, the pimp, would go to Harvey Keitel, who had teamed up and worked with Scorsese before on Who's That Knocking at My Door, Mean Streets, and Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, before collaborating again with Scorsese for Taxi Driver. For preparation for the role, Keitel found and rehearsed with, quote, an ex-pimp, to understand how someone like that would think and feel. Keitel would later find huge success working with talented filmmakers like Ridley Scott, Quentin Tarantino, and later Wes Anderson. Albert Brooks was cast as campaign manager Tom. Brooks, a comedian by trade, hadn't done any feature film acting before taking the role in Taxi Driver. However, he did direct short films for Saturday Night Live. Since then, Brooks has appeared in films such as Broadcast News, for which he was nominated for an Academy Award, but has also appeared in Drive, Finding Nemo and Finding Dory as the voice of Marlin, as well as additional voices for The Simpsons. Controversially, the role of Iris went to a then 12-year-old Jodie Foster. For the role, Foster would undergo psychological testing so that she wouldn't be emotionally scarred by the role and events that she was subjected to in the film. Foster has also often said how De Niro seemingly took her under his wing, running improv before shooting. Foster would become a successful actor, starring in such films as The Accused, The Silence of the Lambs, Contact, Panic Room, and many more, and being nominated for 4 Academy Awards during her career, winning 2 before subsequently moving into directing, with her directorial debut coming in 1991 with the film Little Man Tate. Foster would also go on to direct a few episodes of House of Cards, Orange is the New Black, Black Mirror, and Tales from the Loop, as well as the 2011 film The Beaver, starring Mel Gibson. In the 1970s, the US economy was stagnating, with people moving away from big cities to residential suburbs. New York was one of the hardest hit cities from this movement and stagnation, which subsequently drained the city of much needed tax revenue. New York was expected to pay yearly over $12 billion on welfare, schools, loan interest, pensions, health and fire services, policing, the New York University, and also other services. But to pay for all this, the city only had income generated by taxes, state aid, and federal aid, equaling $11.5 billion. And in 1975, while filming began on Taxi Driver, the city was locked in a serious fiscal crisis, with debts reaching upwards of $11 billion that had accumulated over a number of years, and it was unable to borrow any more money to offset the debt. New York was faced with the prospect of bankruptcy and defaulting on its debts. Producer Michael Phillips told The Hollywood Reporter, "The whole West Side was bombed out. There really were row after row of condemned buildings, and that's what we used to build our sets. Condemned buildings." To get the right look for the film, Scorsese hired cinematographer Michael Chapman. According to Chapman, the film was inspired by the shooting style of Jean-Luc Godard, stating, "The movie's style was very much influenced, in my mind, and in Marty's too, by Jean-Luc Godard and his cinematographer, Raoul Coutard. Much of the way the movie looks was dictated by the fact we didn't have a lot of time and didn't have a lot of money, and therefore couldn't do traditional things. We couldn't light the streets with big lights. We had to take our level of light down to let New York light itself. Of course, that turned out to be exactly the right thing to do." The film was shot on a low budget of $1.9 million, with many of the actors receiving pay cuts just to get the film made. Scorsese himself only receiving $65,000 for the shoot. One of the most fascinating stories from shooting the film, for me at least, is that the production had to hire protection from gangs that would have potentially caused disruption or harm for cast and crew, especially when shooting in condemned buildings. On this subject, Michael Phillips said, "We built Travis's apartment and Iris's apartment in condemned buildings. We had to hire a gang to protect us from other gangs. It was very arduous." Shooting appeared to go over the allotted schedule, with Michael Phillips taking the brunt of studio pressure. For the final shootout of the film, the production crew had to intricately rehearse, especially when it came to the special effects. Iris's apartment was built, and it took 3 months to cut into the ceiling to allow for the fluid tracking shot at the very end of the shootout. However, over a period of 45 days, shooting was complete. The music for the film was composed by the late Bernard Herrmann, which was his final film score before his death. Scorsese was a big fan of Herrmann and had always wanted him to do the film's score. At the time, Herrmann was famous for his constant collaboration with Alfred Hitchcock, having scored The Trouble with Harry, The Man Who Knew Too Much, The Wrong Man, Vertigo, North by Northwest, Psycho, The Birds, Marine, and Torn Curtain. Herrmann wrote his first film score in 1941 for the classic film Citizen Kane, for which he was nominated for an Academy Award. But it was with his next film that he found success, as he won the Oscar for Best Music for the film All That Money Can Buy. Herrmann would later go on to be nominated 3 more times after this, but on December 23rd, Herrmann viewed a rough cut for his next project, God Told Me To, and met with its director, Larry Cohen. After this meeting, Herrmann would return to his hotel room and died of a heart attack in his sleep on December 24th, 1975, at the age of 64. After the film was finished, it was shown to the MPAA, and it was given an X rating. To combat this, Scorsese desaturated the colour for the final shootout, so the blood was less pronounced, whilst also maintaining the visceral violence at the end. This appeared to appease the ratings board, and the film released with an R rating on February the 9th, 1976. It goes without saying that the film has garnered a legacy as one of the greatest films ever made, but that's not to say it doesn't have its detractors. Upon seeing the film, Richard Schickel said, "The film goes most disastrously wrong when it tries to turn slice-of-life realism into full-scale melodrama. At first, it's interesting and funny when Travis becomes obsessed with a cool socialite, Sybil Shepherd, who is a campaign worker for a too-slick, too-vacuous presidential candidate. However, Travis's failure as presented is more farcical than tragic, and it never adequately explains his becoming a killer." The late Gene Siskel even went on to say, "I hated the last third of the movie. The violence is so strong, I ended up looking away from the film in more ways than one. Not only didn't I see some of the bloodletting, I began not to see the sense of the picture either." The film was also booed at the Cannes Film Festival for its graphic violence. It's also worth noting that the film inspired a real-life assassination attempt on Ronald Reagan in 1981 by a man named John Hinckley Jr. Hinckley was seemingly fixated with Jodie Foster, and in an attempt to impress her, he tried to assassinate President Ronald Reagan. It was after this that Scorsese briefly thought about quitting film altogether. However, this didn't stop the film from receiving, despite some negative reception, critical acclaim, with the film receiving 4 Academy Award nominations, 7 BAFTA Award nominations, as well as winning the Palme d'Or at the Cannes Film Festival. The film now has a fantastic legacy, with it going down as arguably one of the greatest films ever made, appearing in many top 100 lists. One of the things that really hits you watching the film is one of its main characters. And no, I'm not talking about Travis. It's New York itself. With filming taking place at the height of the potential New York City bankruptcy, the aesthetic seeps with decay, the streets themselves seemingly hazed and hazardous, dreamlike in a sense, giving off this air of necrosis that seems to seep into every frame at night. It's one of the reasons why I mentioned a brief history of New York in the production segment. And it's a film that delves into isolation and loneliness, its main character, Travis Bickle, being a vessel for these emotions. You start to really understand what sort of mindset Schrader must have been in writing the film, as Travis finds himself delving deeper into unhinged territory as he looks on at the city he lives slipping further into rot. It's also a character study of what loneliness and isolation might do to a person if gone unchecked. And De Niro himself is brilliant in the lead role, quiet and often stoic, never showing his true emotions until absolutely necessary. And it's a terrifying performance, and you really feel that behind the normal-looking exterior of Travis that lurks an absolute beast, ready to cause harm. There isn't actually a bad performance in the film, with Jodie Foster seemingly at points upstaging De Niro in scenes they're in together. It's a terrific turn for, at that point, a young Jodie Foster. And the scenes involving her are often very, very uncomfortable to watch, and purposefully so. And the film doesn't shy away from its sleazy atmosphere either. Everything that takes place at night seems to have a hazy feel to it, the camera lingering on and emphasising Travis's viewpoint. You do, at least at the beginning, seem to connect with his point of view. However, throughout the film, as Travis becomes more and more unhinged, you see him for what he truly is. And the music by Bernard Herrmann really epitomises the state of mind Travis must be in as it flip-flops between calm and collected to utterly chaotic. This shift seems to happen mostly at night, but also when Travis is alone in his apartment. It's a brilliant score by Herrmann. The film overall is a brilliant psychological study of its main character's state of mind and really does deserve the praise it's been given, despite some truly uncomfortable scenes and some brutal violence. It's a great film and has deserved its place in history as one of the best. The beer I've chosen to pair with Taxi Driver is Fuller's Black Cab Stout. Being aesthetically similar to the film with its dark taxi on the front of the bottle, I thought this was a perfect choice for the film. The beer is described as an aromatic dark beer and a stout that delivers a rich, full flavour from the chocolate malts in the brew. For me, it's great tasting beer, not overly strong as some stouts, or at least the stouts or dark beers I've tried, which usually taste and smell like burnt toast. The chocolate malts in this aren't too overpowering, and it does leave you with quite a divine taste. It's great beer, and one I would very much like to recommend. With its legacy cemented as arguably one of the greatest films put to screen, and subsequently one of the most real, Taxi Driver has gone down in history, being inducted into the US National Film Registry and included on many all-time lists. It really is an extraordinary piece of filmmaking, with some highly uncomfortable subject matter that draws inspiration from sleaze and the dark underbelly of society. So, that brings this retrospective of Taxi Driver to a close. I hope you've enjoyed. Please comment, like, and subscribe. And in our next retrospective, we jump into the mind of David Lynch to look at what is said to be his bona fide masterpiece, his 2001 surreal and dreamlike film, Mulholland Drive.